Man, did you hear what he said today? It's going to be like 95 degrees.
95 degrees?
Yeah, imagine what it's going to be like in those trucks.
For NASCAR Craftsman race truck drivers, the heat here in Denver could be unbearable. The track, a 3/8 of a mile traffic nightmare.
In this traffic jam,
how I hate to be late. It hurts my motor to go so slow. Time I get home, I'll stop before.
This traffic jam.
Number 16, Ron Hornaday, is going to try to steer his way successfully through the heat and the havoc for his third win in a row. Get ready, Colorado National Speedway's ready to sizzle. Indeed, things ready to heat up in the second half of the 1997 season. This is race number 14, and it's coming to you from Mile High, Denver. It was Horace Greeley who said, go west, young man. I don't know what he said about turning 250 laps round and round on a 3/8 mile track, but that's what some 12 rookies and a couple of freshman drivers intend to do today against some of the best racing truck drivers, the very best in the world. We've got it all for you on CBS. How tough is this race? How close can it be? Well, let's go back to 1995 and the finish.
Charging for the finish. He puts the fender right in the door of Butch Miller. Here they come out of four, side by side, to the line. I think you can give it to Miller.
I think it's Miller.
Miller by 2 inches.
Hello, everybody. Ken Squire welcoming you aboard for our CBS flag-to-flag coverage. That race was decided by 0.1 of a second. A year later, they went up to 250 laps, and we saw some great racing there. And we also saw a demolition derby before it was over. 14 cautions and 37 laps under yellow just a year ago. What will transpire today? That's what we're here to find out. Now, as to what these drivers are going to face, and what strategy they use, who better to tell you than Buddy Baker?
You know, short track racing sometimes is a game of touching the other guy to get an advantage. The truck on the inside may be a little bit quicker, but this guy has the preferred line around the racetrack, and to get him out of there, sometimes you have to use the right front corner on the left rear just enough to get him offline. Then you get your truck in position to get a good run down the straightaway, and once you get the inside line, that is the preferred line. You can make the pass going in the next corner, but I guarantee you one thing. Buddy Baker never used that bump-and-go tactic, but these guys will today. You can count on it.
Oh, sure, Baker. Right, yes. And politicians never lie, and polar bears make great pets. Right, Buddy. Hey, this track, 3/8, it's what they call a compound bank, a progressive bank, and it really does get nasty out here. It's an old track, the asphalt well used up. No matter where you go, you can be in a handful of trouble. Now, there's something a little different here today, too. When you go into the pits, you enter in turn two, and you re-enter the raceway down here in turn four. So you really got to be on your very best performance as you get through there and not go over the speed limit of 35 miles per hour. Let's go down to Ned Jarrett, who can tell us more about the banking.
Ken, I'm in turn one. Unlike the Louisville Motor Speedway where these trucks ran last week, this track does not have a unique design. It's pretty basic. It's an oval track, but it's certainly not without challenge. It has a varying degree of banking in the turns. Now, this bottom groove that they'll use in the early part of the race here today is banked only 6 degrees. Really, that's pretty flat. Then it graduates up to about 9 degrees as you go up into the second and third grooves. Now, over the years, this track has a lot of laps on it and has become very abrasive, and they expect a lot of tire wear here today. That's a major concern going into this race. Now, when they qualified here yesterday, they were using new tires, and they'll have new tires on the trucks to start with here today. They have this nice surface on the tires, all of it getting to the ground, so they get good traction. But after they run 15 or 20 laps, tires start getting worn, then they'll start sliding up the track. The more they slide, the more it wears the rubber off the tires, and that becomes a problem for the drivers in keeping it down on the racetrack. They just scoot up to the high side. Now, when the tires wear like this, it not only affects the side bite of the tires when you're going into and going through the corners, but also the acceleration coming off of the turns with your rear tires. That will be a major concern. And those who have their trucks set up so they can get that good acceleration off the turns, they're the ones that will prevail here today. Now, Mike Joy is over in turn four with a couple of the drivers that might know just how to do that.
Rick Corelli all but lapped the field here in a Southwest Tour race, and he and Ford driver Joe Ruttman discussing strategy and tire management and how to get through this toughest part of the racetrack, turn four.
Yeah, you know, our biggest charge is going to be is trying to keep the tires under us, but this racetrack creates a lot of problems. You got a lot of bumps coming off it, too, and then you tend to get loose here on the bottom, so it's going to, whoever saves the tires is going to be the good one.
So how do you save them?
I'd say about halfway you come in and you buy as much of that as you possibly can and try to glue it back on as rapidly as you can, because I question the tire going the distance and how hard you're going to run. And that's what Rick and I were just talking about, is it's going to be interesting at about 75 laps. If it looks like a skating rink out here, you'll understand what the problem is.
Rick, is there a way to drive through these corners to conserve your truck?
I think the best way to try and do it is, you know, once we start off the tires new, we'll be able to make a nice round arc through. But I think everybody's got their truck set up good and tight, where you're going to come in and try and drive it in and diamond the corners more, and try and keep the truck coming off good and straight, because the minute you slip them, that's going to be a lap you're going to lose in the long run.
Has there been a race in this series yet when everybody was so uncertain as to what they were going to do?
There was a couple, but I would say this one's real obvious here, that it's going to be major, major management. And some of the guys are saying they can do it, but I think that all hinges on the amount of cautions you get. Who knows that? I mean, we could fire off and have no cautions, and then what are you looking at? So I'd say my call would be, if I stayed real close to Butch Miller, that chances are I'd probably maybe have some tires at 125.
Ken, a lot of question marks here about strategy and the stamina of the tires today.
Thank you, Mike. A lot of questions indeed. You know, on the track, it's every driver for himself. But off the track, it's a totally different story. And this past week, we saw that story told beautifully as several of the drivers paid tribute to John Nemechek, who tragically lost his life in that terrible crash earlier this year at Homestead, Florida. Thursday, the Sanctuary Golf Course hosted a charity golf tournament raising money for the John Nemechek family. John's brother and sister, along with mother Martha, attended the tournament.
Thank you for coming out and remembering John. And NASCAR, I've got to say many, many thanks to NASCAR people and the team. They're part of our family, too. And it's really been special to be a part of all of you. Thank you so much.
$25,000 was raised, and eight of the NASCAR Craftsman truck drivers participated. That included Ron Hornaday, showing some great form there. While his playing partner, Rick Corelli, decided to take a different approach to the game. Yeah. It was a great day, and the drivers said they were honored to be part of the charity program.
To come out here to do something for the Nemechek family and to support everybody, I mean, this is what this whole series is about. We're a big family, and you know, I'm sure the Nemechek's appreciate it, and I know I do, just for a good cause.
You know, and it's a great thing just to see Martha and all the family and everybody back here. I mean, it shows how tight-knit everybody is, you know, how much we lost, and how, you know, how much we respect everything we have.
When we return, you'll meet one of the most brilliant talents in truck driving, the man on the pole. He's almost a member of the CBS family. He showed up so much over the last couple of weeks. Ron Hornaday on the pole today. Can he make it three in a row and tie Mike Skinner's record? We're about to find out.
CBS Sports coverage of the NASCAR Craftsman Truck Series is sponsored by Ford and your Ford dealer. Have you driven a Ford lately? Mobil 1, 100% synthetic motor oil. Nothing outperforms Mobil 1. And by Econolodge. Spend a night, not a fortune, at Econolodge.
Welcome back to the Centennial State, one of the Lord's favorites. Colorado's where we are. And what great weather we have for today's race. We're protected by broken clouds, so the temperature hasn't risen all the way into the 90s like yesterday. A possibility of showers, but a slim one at that, as we get ready to go racing today. And the man everybody is talking about all over America is the guy that's won two straight. Can he win three today? That's the question. On number 16, Ron Hornaday. Let's meet Dr. Dick Bergen with the gentleman on the pole right now.
Ken, this California speedster is the favorite to win the race today, and why not? He's won three out of the last four of these truck races. He's last year's series champion. Hey, in the last three races, he's gone from 11th to 7th to 4th in the points. This guy likes to go fast, but with this tire situation, Ron, how do you do that and still have the tires on when you get to the halfway point?
Well, about like what we did at Louisville. You got to go slow to go fast, and we take this Napa Brake Chevrolet and just try to save the tires. But one thing I got to say is Buster Mulholland, when everybody's with you with Napa. His mom passed away Wednesday, but we're all looking for you. We're going to do this race for you.
He's going to try to win it for him. His crew chief, Freddie Graves, is very much used to running vehicles that have too much power for the tires. He's an ex-super modified driver, won a whole bunch of those things. How good is this guy at doing that, saving those tires?
Well, Ron has a very educated foot, and that's what it takes to win a race here, because the track is very abrasive, and the right side tires just go away in about 60 or 70 laps, and we just need to save them for 125.
Well, good luck to you guys. Let's go to Bill Stevens.
This guy is certifiably hot. Mike Wallace has had two starts so far this season and two top 10 finishes. On the outside of the first row, what's the plan? You're going to try to race Ron into turn one at the green flag?
Well, we're all going to try to beat Ron into turn one. You know, he's heck on restarts. But we're going to race him hard the first lap. If we can't get the job done, we're going to try to fall in line behind him. It's a tire management race. The tires are wearing extremely hard. Pure Later, Pure One trucks running real well, handling well. The guys in Ken Trader race team have done a great job, and we're looking forward to bringing them a win here today, hopefully.
This could be the matchup to watch. Back to you, Ken Squire.
Late updates. This number seven changed engines, as did Rich Bickle this morning. Tammy Jo Kirk has qualified well for today's race. We're going to tell you exactly where she's qualified, and we'll bring you the starting lineup in a moment. There she is herself, getting in there, taking the engine out of the backup truck and putting it into her race truck, getting ready for today's event. She's tucked in her ponytail. She's ready for some full contact truck racing. Coming up, the green flag.
Welcome back to Colorado. Mike Joy with Buddy Baker and Ned Jarrett. Ken Squire across the way. Bill Stevens and Dick Bergeron trackside today, waiting for the command to fire off this field of NASCAR Craftsman trucks.
And now here we are, Todd Hayner, for the, of course, the introduction and the magic words that we will say. And Todd, stand by right here. As all the drivers are lined up in their cars, they're all set to go. A field of 30. Hanging on just 1 second. Official word from NASCAR, and we'll get it here in just about 2 seconds. Here we go. We're just do it right now. Go ahead, Todd.
On behalf of Snap-on, our worldwide affiliates, gentlemen, start your engines.
In the heat of the high plains, 30 trucks roar to life. Here's how they line up today. Behind Ron Hornaday Jr., four-time winner this season. Mike Wallace, you've met. He's on the outside pole, both in Chevys. Rich Bickle is the point leader, and Tony Raines, one of the rookie leaders. They both won this year. Boris Said qualified fifth. He'll start out back. Mike Bliss looks for his first win of the year. Rick Crawford, number two rookie on the tour, and Vic Butchmiller, who won the inaugural here. The Virginia gentleman, Jimmy Hensley, and locals hot shoe, Jerry Robertson in row five. Brian Reffner, last year's Rookie of the Year, and rookie contender Tony Roper. Jay Sauter from Wisconsin, and Stacy Compton, who had a great run last week in his Ford. Dave Resendiz from Massachusetts, and local driver Gary Higgs makes his debut. Joe Ruttman from California, and Tammy Jo Kirk from Georgia. Michigan's Bob Keselowski, and a hot rookie, Kevin Harvick. Watch the little fella. Rick Corelli from Denver, and Jack Sprague from Michigan pick up where they left off last week. Side by side, Chuck Bound and Bill Sedgwick from the West Coast. Tom Hubert makes his first start, and Terry Cook from Ohio. Kenny Irwin Jr.,
from Indianapolis, and Randy Nelson from California. Doug George from California, and a late add to the field is Kenny Allen from North Carolina. Those are the 30 starters. Every truck that was here qualified to start this race. Morissette is dropping to the back of the field. When the truck was lined up online, fluid dripping from the nose led NASCAR to have a closer look. Blocks of dry ice between the grill and the radiator. They sent him bound back. They had to remove that and allowed him to restart at the back of the field. Further action on that expected from NASCAR.
Well, let's look at the manufacturer's breakdown today. You have 14 Fords, 12 Chevrolets, and 4 Dodges. You see Chevrolet leads with 9 wins this year and also win in the manufacturer's point with 101.
There are 30 trucks starting the race today, 250 laps, a little less than 100 miles. It's a two-segment race. They'll go 126 laps in the first segment, and then they'll have a five-minute break. They can change tires, make adjustments to the truck, come back and run 124 laps. And it's open pits. That means they can go into the pits any time during green flag runs, do anything they want to do to them. But if they change tires and a tire's not flat, then it's 5 laps per tire penalty. So you don't want to have to change tires. Total purse, over $320,000 here today.
He'll be riding along today with Ron Hornaday, starting from the pole in the Napa Brake Chevrolet. And he'll ride with a fourth place starter, Tony Raines, driving the Pennzoil Dodge of Kurt Roehrig. Shotgun on the field now, Boris said, the Federated Auto Parts 1-800-COLLECT-FORD of Urban Simo Racing. And the number two of Mike Bliss, the Team ASE Ultra Wheels Ford of Jim and Marlene Smith. And our fifth in-car camera, on board Jimmy Hensley in that Cummins diesel Dodge. More on the Morissette story. Here's Dick Berggren.
Here's why they put that dry ice in front of the radiator, Mike. Two good reasons. One, the air going back and being cooled off before it gets to the engine. As important, however, they want weight in the front of the truck at the beginning of the race. Then they need it in the back. That's all for handling. So this served a dual purpose. Boy, you can't get much by these NASCAR inspectors.
So Seth will start out back as we're ready to go for 250 laps. The big question here, tire management. Keeping that truck underneath you till halftime.
And this right here, who's going to get the jump in the turn one?
Hard to beat Ron Hornaday in that situation.
Good, clean start. A lot of smoke out of number 26, Robertson. He drops to the inside. Everybody goes by.
Hey, look at Mike Wallace pull up on the outside of Ron Hornaday coming off turn four now.
Ned, as long as he can do it, Hornaday looked like he had a little puff of smoke come out of the exhaust pipe as he started off the corner there, like he might be loaded up just a little bit. As you can see, he's got a problem right now. He's losing a good bit of track position.
Robertson drops to the infield, a lot of smoke out the left header bank. Hornaday is about to lose second place to Tony Raines, the pole sitter, the man who led every lap last week at Louisville, has dropped to third, and Rick Crawford, number 14 on the outside, challenges Hornaday and takes third place away.
Boy, Mike Wallace is just doing exactly what he needs to do at the moment, but Hornaday's dropping more positions on the inside.
Rick Crawford has gone past. Hornaday's down to the inside, holding his own, but Mike Bliss has passed. Yep. And now Rich Bickle's knocking on the door.
Mike, I would predict that he has an engine problem because they're doing it on the straightaway. They just flew right by him on the straightaway. He seems to be okay in the turns.
Single file, the first dozen trucks now. And back about 20th place, a lot of side-by-side, but the big question is, as Ron Hornaday looks for three in a row, he started on the pole, and he's already dropped three positions. Caution flag is out. Running slow down on the apron is Jerry Robertson in 26, and the pack really stacks up as they come around to this first caution flag of the day. Comes out at lap 5.
Well, back in the pack, Mike, near the end of the pack, there were 4 wide coming to the checker, to the start-finish line there as they got the caution flag.
Bill Stevens, what's wrong with our pole sitter?
Actually, it's just part of the strategy. They are saving the tires on that truck. It's a strategy that several of the drivers talked about. They're going to lay back the first half of the race, not make any mistakes, keep that rubber fresh, and have it for the second half.
Wow. We talked to some of the drivers in the pit area this morning, and there was a thought expressed
that a driver could get lapped here in the early going, running a pace to save his tires and come back and win this race.
Mike, you and I have watched the 16 of Hornaday run a many a race. Have you ever seen him drop back at the first part of a race to save tires? I think maybe it was loaded up a little bit. It may be back up to full song now, but I think he had a problem right at first.
Well, Dick Bergeron is with Hornaday's crew chief, Fred Graves.
Well, how about it, Freddie? Being conservative with his truck, or have you got a problem?
Well, he just asked me if that was slow enough for me, and I said, yeah, just save the tires. We'll see what we got at the end.
Well, these guys are not only fast, right, they're smart, Mike.
I thought it would be a cold day in July in Denver when Ron Hornaday would drive around here with an egg between his foot and the throttle pedal.
Yeah, me too. And to watch him on the straightaways, they were just blowing by. Of course, he was running half throttle, I guess, letting them by to run the pace that he thinks he needs to run.
Well, last week, the racetrack was very similar to this, and it was the tire management, and he led every lap. So, you know, each week brings on a new situation. I just don't know.
Well, it's either the smartest drive we've seen this season, or somebody's lying through their teeth. But it's Mike Wallace, the race leader. From the outside pole, Tony Raines, who started fourth, has moved up to second. Third is Rick Crawford. Fourth now is Mike Bliss, and Ron Hornaday has dropped to fifth. Well, Hornaday has won three of the last four races. We asked drivers, what do you have to do to beat him?
Knock him out. That's one way. I don't know. I mean, that's coming real quick. You know, give him a quarter panel or a rear deck lid or something, and that knocks him out.
I guess we just have to do our homework a little bit better and, you know, just all in out beat him. You know, Ron is just real good when it comes to short track.
Somebody's going to have to stop him this week. Hopefully his luck is just about out and ours is just starting.
I outdrove Hornaday all day yesterday on the golf course, so hopefully one of these days I'll be able to do it on the track.
Right. That's Boris. Said he wanted to go back and tell his road race friends that he outdrove Hornaday this weekend. On the golf course, he did. On the racetrack, we'll see. Brian Reppner moves up the outside, and he passes Hornaday. Here's a look at your leader, Mike Wallace, who's led every lap.
Going down into turn three there, you see he's right on the yellow line all the way through the corner, Mike. Look at Tony Raines in second place there in the 19th. He's running very well.
Rick Crawford having a great rookie season. He is running third in that blue Ford. Mike Bliss hasn't won a race yet this year. Could be his day. And here on the outside comes Brian Reppner. Look at Reppner, top of your screen on the outside of Mike Bliss and Dale Phelan's number 66. Last year's rookie of the year. Working the outside, he may get Crawford as well in the backstretch.
Well, he said, I passed Hornaday on the outside. If I pass him on the outside, I should be able to get these other guys. Boy, he does it. That's great moves by Brian Reppner.
Ned, that's one of the features of the track with this compound or progressive banking. The top groove is the long way around, but it's steeper banked and it may be just as fast as the bottom.
And Mike Bliss, he says, okay, I've seen Reppner do that. Why can't I do it? And he does. He passes Rick Crawford on the outside, moves up to fourth.
So Reppner becomes the rabbit.
Well, let's see where Reppner runs when he does not have to pass anybody. He's right back down on the bottom. Even the left side went on the curbing there just a little bit in the middle part of two.
Brian Reppner runs in third behind Mike Wallace and Tony Raines. It's Chevy, Dodge, Ford, Chevrolet. Ron Hornaday has dropped back to sixth position, where he runs a pace, holding the rest of the pack at bay.
Yeah, he really is holding him at bay, Mike. In fact, everybody behind him, they're scrambling back there, some of them side by side, just trying to...
Here he is.
Yeah, you can see that pack behind him running bumper to bumper. Back there in the pack, they're running side by side. That's sort of the menu for a wreck.
Tammy Jo Kirk, new engine on the move. Here she is outside of Jack Sprague. Bill Stevens?
Tammy Jo Kirk is not even in the fast groove, Mike. She's on the outside, has not been on the inside of the racetrack during the race. Watch how late she brakes. The way that she's passing these trucks, she's going deeper into the turn. She got by Corelli, she got by Compton, and it looks like Sprague will be her next victim.
Here's Rick Corelli, though, moving underneath Kirk. Corelli, the master of this speedway.
Well, Jack Sprague, he decides to try to make a couple of moves of his own down on the inside, following Joe Rutman through by Bob Keselowski.
Boy, that's heavy. That's rush hour traffic right there. Look, there's Rutman in the 80, left side of your screen. Right in the midst of that pack, Keselowski trying to move up the outside, and Jack Sprague slides in with a little tap, love tap on Rutman.
Whoa, trouble.
Chuck Bown.
Turn four. Chuck Bown is around. No flag. We're going to stay green.
Yeah, he gets going. You just made a 360 down, got down the dirt a little bit. And so Chuck Bown keeps going, drops all the way to the rear of the pack.
Stays on the lead lap. Look at this pack. Now there's 35 Dave Resendiz. Keselowski, that black and white Dodge, trying to climb the ladder on the outside.
And Mike, this is what happens when you got a truck like Ron Hornaday up there. He's running a good pace, but he's more trouble here on the front straightaway.
Designated spin, Gary Higgs, number five, first ever.
Still
turn
no
in
caution.
Craftsman truck spins down the front straight, continues. We stay green.
And what I was saying, Ron Hornaday running the pace that he seems to want to run there as the five truck gets lapped now by the leader. It's bunching everybody else up back there. They can go faster than what he's leading them. And they think, well, boy, I want to get up there while I got this opportunity. And it's really causing a little beat in the bank.
This is the middle of that pack. Let's show you what happened to Chuck Bown in turns three and four. You're looking from Boris Sed. Look at the top of your screen. Two trucks ahead.
Mike, I didn't see any contact at all. It looked like he just got in there very hard and just got sideways.
Could have been a little bit going into the turn before they actually got into the turn.
That's Bill Sedgwick in the number four. Here's your leader, Mike Wallace. Tony Raines is being challenged for second. Reffner on the outside of Tony Raines. Going to try to climb this ladder all the way to second place. On the outside, going to make the pass. So make it Wallace in a Chevy, Reffner in a Ford, Raines in a Dodge, your top three.
Mike, what happens there when a car truck gets on the outside there coming out of the corner, he cuts off the angle to get back on the straightaway so you can't get back in the throttle. So the inside truck has to wait until he gets way down the straightaway to get wide open.
Spin in turn four, going around the 82 of Randy Nelson. The 18-year-old grabs a gear and continues just in front of the second place truck. And again, no caution. It's getting wilder out here in the West in Denver. CBS Sports coverage of the Colorado 250 will continue after this message and a word from your local station. Welcome back to the Colorado 250. Mike Wallace leads Brian Reffner and Mike Bliss, Tony Raines, to the caution flag. Comes out for the second time today. Caution at lap 34. And nobody spun, but the track crew has gone out to the backstretch to pick up a piece of debris. There it is. Looks like a brake duct hose.
That's exactly what it is. That comes from the front of the truck and goes back into the brake to cool it. That's fresh air to the brakes.
Well, either
not anymore.
It either fell off or got bumped off.
There's part of the,
there's the
where
duct.
It hooks into the front of the truck.
I would say the bumping started that to come off. Knocked it loose and then finally worked its way off.
I'd say that's a good question. Ned, I'm not laughing. I just know how fast you can destroy a truck in a racetrack.
Doesn't take long. Let's go high atop turn three to the pagoda, Ken Squire.
Yes, up here at the Caleb's tent. This Mike Wallace run, he is not running that truck that hard. They've all detuned so dramatically for this race. Going to make for a very interesting battle all day. And both Hornaday and Bickle have picked up their pace. That brought the rest of the field up a little. And as they did, it set the Tammy Joe Kirk and the Keselowski trucks back a bit. That Mike Wallace truck up in front, he had intended to have a drag battle for the lead coming down for the start, and it never happened as Hornaday backed up. Here's Bill Stevens.
Chuck Bown at truck number 99 obviously had some contact on that spin. The left rear fender is pushed in. It's rubbing on the tire very badly. That's exactly what you don't need when tire management is the name of the game today.
Bown's crew will have an eye on that. There it is at the right side of your screen as we get ready for this restart. He is on the inside of leader Mike Wallace trying to get his lap back when we go green.
Mike would be guessing on that there's so much contact going on behind Hornaday with all the trucks as they go back to green here.
Boris Sed started 30th. He is up to 19th. And on the outside, Brian Reffner puts away Chuck Bown in the 99. Here comes Mike Bliss in the 2. When we went to caution, Bliss was challenging Reffner for second place, and Tony Raines in the Dodge was right on Bliss's bumper. Here's a look at Boris Sed. You ride along with him. Tracking Tammy Joe Kirk down into the corner. Sed started last. And here's Rick Crawford on the inside. working traffic, Rich Bickle moves up in 17, up to the Dodge of Tony Raines, number 19. Now we ride with Raines, following Rick Crawford along.
And Raines, we just passed the last lap by Ron Hornaday, who is on the move. Hornaday also passed the 14 truck of, well, Rick Crawford passed Raines as well. And now Hornaday challenges for third, has got a challenge for the lead.
Brian Reffner brings it off turn number four. Looking on the high side of race leader Mike Wallace and Kenny Schrader's 52.
Well, right now, the good trucks will start really getting forward by it. You see Hornaday, he kind of rested there, and apparently he did just hold back, because you can see right now he's one of the fastest trucks out there.
Boy, he fooled me.
He fooled all of us.
Got to hand it to him.
Hornaday has come back up to fourth place, right on the bumper of Mike Bliss.
Well, now he's backed off a little bit again.
Well, he won't be able to back off much, because Rick Crawford's just behind him in the blue truck here. He's looking inside and outside. I think he wants to pick the pace up.
Hornaday's strategy looks to be, on the restart, get out away from the traffic and the lap trucks, find a smooth place to run and settle in. Now you look ahead at Rich Bickle from the front bumper of Jimmy Hensley's. We have insurance on that camera? We put a camera on the front bumper of one of these trucks? I don't know, buddy.
Let's ride with him a little bit, and look, you see the yellow line right around the base of the track. As Ned said, he moved out just a little bit in the center part, making a diamond part of the corner right in the center, right back to the bottom. Now see him go out just a little bit, back on the throttle, runs right up on Bickle down the front straight away, and right back into turn one.
Jimmy Hensley moving forward. He's up to eighth place. Jay Sauter, left side of your screen, works underneath the lap truck, number 82, Randy Nelson. He's going to drag Dave Resendiz and Joe Rutman with him. Rutman, number 80. Rick Corelli, number 6. Now, Sauter leading this group is in 10th place. This is from 10th on back. Rutman is in 12th in the 80. Here's Corelli, 13th in the number 6. After starting 21st. Let's update the Boris Zedd story, Dick Bergeron.
Well, Boris is moving well through the field, Mike. I'm with his crew chief, Jay Smith. And what is your side of the great dry ice caper?
Better not comment a whole lot on it, but the biggest thing is we're so high up. Overheating is a bad problem up here, and we're just trying to put a Band-Aid on something that couldn't be fixed here. I guess they penalize us a little bit there. It's a lot harder to get back up to the front here. But his truck's good, and just try not to spin the tires. We'll be up there before it's over. That's pretty good politics, isn't it, Mike? He could work for either party.
I would say. Boris is up to 18. He's battling number 4, Bill Sedgwick. There's the lap truck, number 99 of Chuck Bound. And Boris is just adjusting that rear quarter panel on
Whoa.
Chuck's truck, and the front one as well.
You can see Boris Sedd had all four wheels on the flat part beneath the racetrack. He was actually on the apron there.
Ned, we got tire management. How about fender management?
Well, you know, I started to say, banking in a turn will help you in a case like that. You can slide up, and it'll help to cushion and stop the slide. He didn't need no banking that time. He used Chuck Bauer.
Yep, eight tires will always corner better than four.
That's right.
You said it. Kenny Irwin, number 98, and Tom Hubert, the driver in number 18, the Dana Dodge this week, owner Kurt Rorick, is going to rotate among five drivers the rest of the season to get his plans set for 1998. Michael Dokken, who has been in that truck, is one of those five. Among the others rumored for the seat, Busch North standout Jerry Marquis, modified ace Ted Christopher, ASA's Kevin Sawinski, Dokken, and the man in it, Tom Hubert.
Mike, you know Tony Roper in the yellow truck there just behind this group. You see him going through there. He has driven very well this year. That truck was not much of a campaign truck last year, but doing very well this year.
52 laps complete, buddy, here in Denver out of 250. Mike Wallace, Mike Bliss, Brian Reffner, Ron Hornaday, and Tony Raines.
Front, as Mike Bliss in the true truck has caught Mike Wallace in the 52, and Ron Hornaday has caught both of them. Here we go. Bliss moves to the inside, so does Hornaday. Wallace drops back to third.
Okay, these guys drop back the first 10 laps of the race, and now they're back up there fighting for the lead. Bliss never really dropped as far back as Hornaday, but you can see Hornaday has the superior truck as he makes the move on the outside.
Ron Hornaday, power move to the outside of Mike Blitz.
But
front straightaway.
He's got a lap truck there, but he's going to go between them.
Hello. He split Chuck Bown and Mike Blitz right down the middle. Ron Hornaday threads the needle and goes to the front.
Now there's the Ron Hornaday I know, not the one that dropped back there right on the very start of the race, but he made it pay off, and it's paying dividends right now. But you see, Mike Bliss is very capable of making a race out of this.
Nothing wrong with that truck.
I tell you, I applaud him for, first of all, for having the patience, and also for having the foresight.
Now listen to that. What, that telltale whine from Mike Bliss's truck is what?
Well, that's a slick chain rear end that they use in these trucks. On these very short tracks, you really can't get the gearing that you need with a Ford housing. So they go to a slick chain, they can get a lot closer on the gearing. Well, here comes Bliss fighting back on the inside, Mike.
He's got room, but he's got the lap truck of Keselowski just ahead, or he wasn't lapped, but he is now. Bliss has to go back up top. 67, laps complete. We are a quarter distance. Let's follow up on Mike Bliss with Bill Stevens in the infield.
Well, if you're a betting man, you should take a good look at Mike Bliss for being there at the checkered flag. His crew chief, Barry Dodson, told me this track owes them one. Last year, they had a good truck. They were running well. Talk about tire management. They not had one flat. They had two. That took them out of the race. They want this one.
Bliss stalks Ron Hornaday. Now, Hornaday's truck wiggled just a little getting into the corner.
Well, Mike, he's not taking care of the tires right now. He's running very precise, so you can hear inside the truck they're being very easy on the throttle and center part of the corner. And right now, I think you're seeing all these guys just taking it easy, getting in, picking up the throttle very carefully, not to spin the rear wheels.
There's your lead. Hornaday on your left at 16 and Bliss in the Ford. And
you know, Mike Wallace there in third, he dropped back just for a second, but now he's picking up on the leaders just a little bit, Ned.
Yes, he is. He's certainly staying right with them. Now, whether when Hornaday got to the lead that he's slowed down a little bit, I don't know, but Mike Wallace hasn't lost that much ground.
Now, they're staying pretty much static at about a truck length distance between the two, and that may be allowing Wallace to close in.
But they're about to come up on some heavy traffic, Mike, about four or five laps from now, we're going to see them in some heavy traffic that's running side by side as Bliss continues to keep the pressure on.
First and second, single file. Mike Wallace in third. Here's the battle for fourth place. Rich Bickle finally gets around the 66 of Brian Reffner, and here comes Rick Crawford working the outside, and the 43 is Jimmy Hensley.
Just fixing to say, Jimmy Hensley, you're riding with him going into turn three. Listen when he gets back in the throttle here, how nice to see you. Now he's full throttle, now he'll back off. Ride through, now he'll pick the throttle up nice and easy right there and head down the back straightaway.
Very smooth. He's like a driver that told me this morning, he's got a long hinge on the accelerator pedal to try to take care of things. Leader in heavy traffic, Hornaday, bang down to the inside. Trucks underneath Hubert. Kenny Irwin boxed in, nowhere to go. Harvick up on the outside. And again, Hornaday. You think boxing's on tomorrow? Have you seen Hornaday slug his way through here?
Bump and run, man. That's part of short track history.
He's fun to watch.
Now there you hear Hornaday late on the throttle coming up out of turn two, and so smooth.
Mike, he runs the fourth gear in the back of this truck, and he'll run third gear for a while, and when the track gets slick, he pulls it back in high gear. You can hear it starting very little RPM.
Ron Hornaday going for three in a row. Mike Skinner's done it, the only driver in the series to do so, and he is our race leader, Ken Squire.
Right now, Mike Wallace is beginning to feel some real pressure from Rick Bickle back there in a battle for third spot. In fact, Bickle's about to make the attack. Wallace has already moved in the two events previously all the way to 43rd position to standings and is doing an excellent job. He's led early in this going, and he's holding Bickle for the moment. But your battle is back in third. Rich Bickle was another of the drivers they bridled. Now they're letting him loose.
Thanks, Ken. Truck way up high. That's the number five of Gary Higgs, who is headed to the back pit area. 75 laps complete. Rich Bickle bids on Mike Wallace for third spot. He's going to get it, and we'll be right back to Denver. Third time today. Comes out of lap 84. There was debris on the start and finish line from some bumping and banging. Let's show you what happened.
A lot of heavy traffic as those in the lead draft or pack get close together, and that really got close there. Buddy come off of turn two.
Jimmy Hensley was in the throttle in the back end on his truck to start it around there. He's very lucky to catch it. You can see right there.
Well, he had to turn square left when they were about to go three wide there.
Mike Wallace almost got into him. Now, that did not produce the caution. Let's show you this again.
Mike, that'll happen every time when you're wide open and you're right inside of somebody. They made contact coming off that corner over here. He was very lucky to catch that truck.
Now, after that happened, someone lost another brake duct, this time on the front straightaway at start-finish. That's the reason we're under caution. A little more cleanup going on out in turn number three. Let's take a break from Denver. We'll be right back.
Set.
Welcome back to Denver. You see Mike Wallace going out in front of the field. During this caution period, because of the concern about tire wear, because Wallace led most of the early laps, NASCAR brought him in so that his team, NASCAR, and all the crew chiefs could get a good look at what was happening with that truck where the rubber meets the road. Dick Bergren has more.
Well, this was an absolute plan, Mike. They had intended to do this. Timmy Cahoos, the crew chief. Timmy, what do those tires look like to you?
They're giving up for everybody a little bit, but there's no safety problem right now, so we got enough to go to the break.
You should have seen this thing, Mike Choi. Just about every crew chief in this whole place was surrounding that truck with everybody looking at the tires, and Mike Wallace was sitting behind the wheel, turning the steering wheel right and left so everybody could get a good look. Quite a sight, I'll tell you.
I'll bet. Now, because NASCAR asked Wallace to come to the pits for that check, he does not lose the time that he was off the racetrack. Instead, NASCAR's told him to go out around, add a lap, and then pick up his position in line so that he's correct with the official scoring and he is not penalized for the time he spent off the track at NASCAR's request.
Good call by NASCAR. We certainly don't want to see anybody blow a tire out and get in the wall. So that was great.
Safety first. We're set for the restart. We have 91 laps complete. 126 will be halftime. Ron Hornaday, the leader, in a Chevy. Mike Bliss in a Ford. Rich Bickle in a Chevy. Rick Crawford in a Ford. Mike Wallace, fifth in a Chevy. Jay Sauter's Chevy. The Dodge of Jimmy Hensley. The Chevy of Rick Corelli. And then Butch Miller, Stacy Compton, and Brian Reffner. We're back to green. Throttle management from Ron Hornaday.
You can see his footwork down there as he gingerly steps on the accelerator. Of course, that would be his right foot right in that area. And then his left foot there going on the brakes. Easing it through the turn. Then gingerly back on the accelerator. Down the straightaway. Boy, he is so smooth.
Mike, that's the Hornaday we're used to seeing on restarts. Taking the lead and not looking back.
For more on the race leader and pole sitter, Dick Bergren.
Mike, many of the teams chose to detune their engines for this event, the idea being they don't want to chew up the tires. Hornaday's team did not do that. They've got all the horsepower this truck can take and more. Crew chief Fred Graves said, the reason I don't have to do that is I've got a driver with an educated foot. Our traction control is in the seat.
Oh, so he detuned Hornaday. Well, he's the leader, but you see now Mike Bliss has fallen back. Rich Bickle is now up to second, and Bliss has dropped for third, fighting for third on the right side of your screen with number 14, Rick Crawford.
Yeah, you can see Bickle making a nice move on the inside, bringing Rick Crawford right along with him. Your leading truck is just a little bit ahead of him up there, Ron Hornaday.
Yes, Bill Sedgwick separating himself from those trucks now.
We had a report that with about 25 or so laps to go, that the 14 truck of Rick Crawford, that he's been managing his tires, that he was going to try to head to the front, maybe starting a little bit earlier than we predicted.
Well, he's got some pretty big hills to climb before he gets to the lead there, because Rich Bickle's as good as anybody on a slick racetrack.
You know, what a great rookie battle in this series this year. Fellas like Kenny Irwin, Tony Raines, Rick Crawford. There's a long list of talent on this rookie list. And lately, it's been Crawford who's had his truck to the front of the field. Chuck Bown has gone to the back pit area. As you watch Rich Bickle and Rick Crawford battle for second place, Mike Bliss there in fourth, truck number two. And Brian Reffner drops underneath the 18, cuts it sharp. Let's go to Bill Stevens.
Brian Reffner was up toward the front earlier, and it cost him. Those tires are gone. He's reporting that truck is not hooking up anywhere on the track, so don't look for any last-minute heroics before the half ends.
Well, we said early, Ned, he was the rabbit. He climbed to second place, but looks like might have used up some of his tires. Mike Wallace now is dropping back as well. Wallace has dropped from fifth on the restart back to seventh.
And he was certainly the rabbit. He was the man out front there for a long period of time and perhaps ran a little bit harder than he should have.
There's the lead that Ron Hornaday, 16, enjoys on Rich Bickle.
See, Rich Bickle just coming in right there in second place. Rick Crawford right on his tailgate as they go down into turn one. It looks like Bickle's a little bit quicker than Hornaday, but I think Hornaday's watching his tires right now.
There's Mike Wallace. He is drifting back in the field. He is now in eighth place behind Rick Corelli and ahead of Stacy Compton, another of those talented rookies. Back Compton moves on Morissette and Resendi's right behind that truck. And let's check back with the leaders. From Tony Raines, a look at Jack Sprague in the green 24.
Ned, we'll see what they're doing now as far as getting in the corners. You can see right now that Tony Raines has got his hands full right there with the, that's the 31 there, going down in the corner. You can see he's right on the bottom of the racetrack. As a matter of fact, the left side's off on the inside. That's Tony Roper on the outside in the 31.
21 laps to halftime, Ken Squire.
Yes, indeed, and the strategy that was laid out at the outset of this event is paying off. If you're just joining us, it was the number 16, Hornaday, who laid way back, and staying with him way back was Bickle. They gave up seven spots right at the top, planning to make this assault, and that's exactly what they've done. The big story behind that, Bickle in 17, and Hornaday, the leader, is Crawford. He is trying to run down the 17 of Rich Bickle, but with no luck. It looks like they're solid on those tires, Mike. The strategy here could give Hornaday that opportunity to tie Mike Skinner with three straight wins. Skinner's the only man that ever did it before he moved on to Winston Cup.
And Skinner will be back next week in Topeka. Jimmy Hensley, Jay Sauter, battle for fifth place.
Mike, yesterday, Jay Sauter was the fastest truck on the racetrack under the heated condition. It was 95 plus yesterday. Today, he looks like he's running very well. Don't count him out yet, and don't give Hornaday a win yet, because there's a lot of racing to go yet.
There's Rick Corelli, number six, right with them, the home track favorite. This is fifth, sixth, and seventh place. CBS Sports coverage of the Colorado 250 will continue after this message and a word from your local station.
CBS Sports coverage of the NASCAR Craftsman Truck Series is sponsored by Budweiser, the classic American lager. Goodyear, number one in tires. And by Head & Shoulders, because great hair can't have flakes.
Welcome back to Denver, where Ron Hornaday Jr. has put mile track Jack Sprague mile high, one lap down. Hornaday is now setting a blistering pace.
And he's about to put a lap on the guy who led much of this race, Mike Wallace, going into turn three. Look at it, just right upon. Mike's tires are totally gone. And Hornaday still apparently has good tires, puts him a lap down. Now, only 11 trucks on the lead lap.
Hornaday, Rick Crawford, Rich Bickle, Mike Bliss in fourth, Jimmy Hensley fifth, Rick Corelli in sixth, Jay Sauter in seventh, Stacy Compton, the rookie, in eighth, Butch Miller, the tire management king, in ninth, Dave Resendiz and Joe Ruttman are the only trucks on the lead lap as we sneak up on halftime 10 laps from now.
You can see out of Tony Raines' truck there, he's not really hooked up well. They're going by him on the outside, and he's in the preferred line. He's losing a lot of ground here, Ned.
Yeah, he's already a lap down.
Now at lap 126, we'll take our 5-minute halftime break.
Everyone comes to the pits, takes on tires and fuel, lines back up in the order in which they were running, and we go at it again for 124 laps. You're riding with Tony Raines, and that's Rick Corelli just ahead, the sixth place truck. Up front, Ron Hornaday Jr. is putting them away. After, in the first few laps, we thought something was wrong with Hornaday's truck. He was just conserving.
Boy, what smart strategy. Unreal is how this has worked for him.
An educated foot, Freddie Graves calls it, to keep those tires from spinning, keep too much side load on the tires in the corners, and keep them under the truck. Now, let's look back to Rich Bickle in 17. He's now third. Mike Bliss, number two, is fourth. Jimmy Hensley, 43, is fifth. And number six, Rich Corelli, is sixth.
Ed, you can see him going all the way on the flat part of the track, getting in, kind of going back out to the low groove, and then all the way out against the wall. Now, back down. Look, almost four tires on the flat part of the racetrack.
He's about the only guy up there right now that can drive that truck anywhere he wants to drive it. And that is really working to his advantage.
One truck running away from the field. 27 more slip sliding away on worn tires. Now with Tony Raines, see some of that tire deflection. He rolls off into the corner.
Sway bar that we're seeing down there. Sway bar, of course, hooks up on the right side and on the left side to keep the weight from shifting so much when he goes into a turn.
And the starter has the cross flags in the air halfway as Hornaday goes three wide underneath everybody in turn one.
I bet Fred Graves is giving him a... Wow, look at
Ruffin. Look at Ruffin, number 80, trying to stay on the lead lap. They'll come this time to the caution flag. They will race to this caution flag. Ruttman has got to get that board going to stay on the lead lap, and he's not going to make it. Hornaday has now just nine trucks to deal with on the lead lap. What a performance. Ron Hornaday and nine other trucks are on the lead lap as we go to halftime. Tire changes and more when we come back.
Race summary is sponsored by Budweiser, the classic American lager.
Through 126 laps, a race of strategy. Three leaders thus far and three lead changes to date. The average speed, a little bit over 61 miles per hour. And there have been four cautions for 15 laps thus far here today. Three trucks have retired from the competition here at Colorado. Robertson was first out. Allen was the last to retire from the event. And now all the activity at halftime is in the pits. So we need to get there and see what the story is. Hello again, everyone. This is halftime at Colorado National Speedway, and let's get right down and find out what's happening with those leaders. Dr. Dick Berggren is standing by with Rich Bickle.
Well, Rich Bickle has found himself just a tad of shade at the back of his truck. You had Hornaday in your sights for most of the race, and then he took off. What happened to you, or what happened to him?
Well, we're a little bit off on our setup. We're a little bit tight, and it killed the right front. It made the right front build up air pressure, and I was skidding the right front tire really bad. I couldn't even drive in the corner very hard, but we're going to make the right change this diehard Chevrolet right now. We're going to come back out. We're going to put it on that 16 because he's won us so far in a row.
Can you eat him up?
I think if we make the right changes, we got a truck that's plenty capable of doing it. Big tire management race right now. Everybody's saving their stuff for a long time, but we got some stuff we want to do to change it. I think we'll be all right.
Okay, let's go see if Ron Hornaday can do his end of thing. Come on with me, folks. Let's go find Ron Hornaday. I hope I can find Ron Hornaday. Up in the back of the truck is Ron Hornaday. Here he comes. Ron, you're just eating these guys alive. What are you doing up there?
Same thing in Louisville. Gordy Arbrett in that transmission, working at Dennis Fisher's motor. Good combination, good package right now.
Are you shifting in this event?
I'll tell you that after we win. We'll find out. We're not hoping anything, but we got to keep doing what we've been doing. And we've been running fourth gear right now, trying to save the tires. And we're going to free the truck up a little bit more. Everybody's complaining about loose, and ours is too tight. So free it up a little bit more, run that fourth gear, we'll be all right.
Wow, this ought to be something. DeBill Stevens.
with Mike Bliss. As you can see, it's air management right here. A fan blowing some cool air on this guy who's plenty hot. How about those tires? Are they holding up all right, Mike?
Yeah, they did. Surprisingly, we started to get a little loose, but that was a long time on those tires. But the Goodyear tires stuck in there the whole way. We're just trying to conserve ourselves, wait for the next half.
Next half's coming up. Are you going to go a little harder?
Yeah, at the end of the race, we will.
Meaning maybe with 10 or 15 laps left?
Yeah, probably. We've got to make sure Hornaday don't get out in front of us.
What about inside the truck? It looks pretty hot.
It isn't too bad, really. It's a little warm, but not too bad.
All right, he's got to get out of the way, and so do I. Let's go to Dick Bergeron.
Rick Crawford is running in second position. He's got a third in this series, but never a second. How's the truck? You going to be able to do that?
Well, I couldn't hear what you're saying.
I was just asking you if you could keep where you are or if you could do something with Hornaday.
I'd like to say we could, but feathering this gas on this big Ford, the Circle Bar Motel and RV Park Ford, that's a... I'm pulling the reins all the way back on my horse, and my horse is like secretariat. I mean, it's wanting to go to the front, and but we're trying to hold the reins back. I don't wish nothing bad on anybody, but Hornaday's just playing with us.
Well, amazingly enough, this truck that's running in second position right now is the same one that was virtually demolished last week. They made the driver, Crawford, work on it. They said he was the participant. To Bill Stevens.
With Jay Sauter. Jay, are you happy with the way the tires have held up in the first half?
Yeah, I'll tell you, Goodyear had a real good tire here. Tire management is always the key, but we got a good truck here today, and we're just going to be careful for the second half.
You went into the race with a certain strategy. Have you followed it?
Yeah, I probably used up a little more tire than I should and lost a couple of positions before the half here, but we're in good shape for the second half.
He's very optimistic. Let's go to Dick Bergeron.
And I'm with Rick Corelli. He's won 31 times at this racetrack. What are we going to see in the last half, Rick?
Well, hopefully we can move some more. We moved up about 13, 14 positions, so hopefully we can get this Remax Chevrolet up front. We sort of ran that first race the strategy and saved the tires. We got a little left, so we can use them up.
Going to gas it the second half?
We're going to have to gas probably about 20 to go. We're going to use everything there's got left.
Well, he's the local favorite, Ken Squire.
A lot of question marks here. A totally different truck event than we've ever seen before. More of halftime and more of the strategy here in Colorado when we return. Dramatic countryside, this Colorado. Dramatic race at Colorado National Speedway. We're at halfway in an event where Ron Hornaday set on the pole, backed up to seventh position, and then is charged back into the lead. And the field is regrouping, and Mike Bliss seems to be in trouble. Let's go back down here in the pit area. Dick Bergeron.
Ken, it's double trouble. They're just buttoning up the hood on this truck. He's got an overheating problem. They put some more water in the radiator. And back here, they had this wheel off. Why? So they can change the battery. He lost the battery in the first half. And when the battery goes down, tell you what, the ignition goes down too. Mike Joy.
Well, what a wild first half. The two rabbits, Mike Wallace and Brian Reffner, ended up well back in the running. And the fellow who saved his tires most, Ron Hornaday, Ned, he'll show you what you can do when you save that truck, what you can do with it in the waiting lap.
Well, just on the very last lap, he made it three wide as he came around trying to put Joe Ruttman a lap. He's the yellow truck up on the outside, number 80. Tom Hubert in the middle in the blue truck. Hornaday has enough traction off the turn to get back to the start-finish line first. Put Joe Ruttman a lap down, and boy, that could be a big move before the end of this race.
Buddy, I think Ron Hornaday fooled everybody in the place and at home except himself and Freddie Graves.
Well, he certainly fooled me, but I tell you one thing. He put on a tremendous show, but remember one thing. Everybody's had a chance to work on those trucks now, make adjustments. Ron Hornaday won't have it that easy the second half, I don't think.
Well, let's go back high atop turn three to Ken Squire.
Well, though, whatever you see here today will be the last time you see it here. They're going to change this track. It's all going away, going to be bulldozed down. The plan for the future, 5/8 of a mile. And Mr. Chesserone is saying that the track here will be the Charlotte Motor Speedway of short tracks, some 22,000 seats. But it's certainly given us some great action here on CBS in the last 3 years. And for fans in this part of the country out here in Colorado, this is what it's all about. Every Saturday night, they get together and have a real old-fashioned hoedown with cars in the wall, upside down, a lot of action. The trucks have run it totally differently than ever before. Let's go to Bill Stevens.
And Ken, you can only hope the new track is going to be a little easier on tires. Look at this chocolatey mess right here. That used to be part of a racing tire. But the tires get hot, and this track is like a 3/8 mile emery board. It just grinds the tires down, and on the outside of the groove, you find pieces of rubber like that all the way around. Tell you how bad it is. They have a machine here that sweeps the outside of the groove. I looked at it today. The right front tire of that truck is shredded. Back to you.
Thanks, Bill. They are lined up for the second half. There's your race leader, Ron Hornaday. Rick Crawford, Rich Bickle, Mike Bliss, Jimmy Hensley, Rick Corelli, Jay Sauter, Stacy Compton, Butch Miller, and Dave Resendiz are all on the lead lap. Joe Ruttman did just barely get lapped, get tipped at the caution flag. He and Roper, Sprague, Reffner, Wallace, Raines, Kirk, Cook, and Irwin are one lap down.
And are we going to see a bunch of people put their brakes on here and race towards the back?
And next week, a whole different kind of racing. Brand new Super Speedway at Madison, Illinois. The Gateway 300 Bush Race will be live on CBS.
Mike, if you want to know who's the lap down after we talk just for a second about our IRL race.
That's a mouthful. But it's in Charlotte. And Sunday, next Sunday at 1 o'clock, you'll see the 500 kilometers for the Indy Racing League as they tackle the high banks at Charlotte Motor Speedway.
Folks, if you want to know who's the lap down, just look on the inside there. Every truck on the inside of this lineup right here is at least one lap down right now.
And when I said, are we going to see a race towards the back, that's what Ron Hornaday did at the beginning. Will others take a cue from that and say, hey, we need to go slow here at the first part of this race, this last half of this race, to save our tires?
Excellent point, Ned. And will Hornaday do it again?
He's about got to.
Yeah.
You know, he did it before, and should give Joe Ruttman, some of these guys, a chance to get their lap back, but they're going to use their tires up doing it.
Getting set for the restart. CBS.Sportsline.com will have the finish of today's race and analysis, and I'll chat with you live Monday night at 7 p.m. Eastern Time on Sportsline. Right now, though, we're set to go racing. What will Hornaday do? If he slows down, will everyone else slow down to his pace? Or will someone else want to be the rabbit?
Well, I'm going to bet you that the 80 truck of Joe Ruttman's going to try to jump him on the start here and get back and hope for an early caution.
Has to. Joe Ruttman has to get back on the lead lap. Will Hornaday give him enough room to go?
I think he'll have to. He's had the preferred groove here down on the inside as they get the one to go this time around. You can see the caution lights are still on top of the truck. There you see the signal.
Now the two trucks that were rabbits in the first half, Ryan Reffner and Mike Wallace, will both line up on that inside lane one lap down. Two rookies having a great run today. Rick Crawford in the number 14 in second place. Stacy Compton, the Virginia driver out of late model stock, he's in that number 86. Stacy Compton up and on the lead lap. He's in eighth place.
Mike, you see the trucks going back and forth there, getting the rubber off the tires right now to clean them so they'll stick real good when they drop the green. The main reason for that, I walked around here yesterday and got build up on my tennis shoes, much less what the trucks are doing.
What compound were you running?
That's all the way down to a T9, I think.
Let's get at it, folks, for the second half. 124 laps to go. Ron Hornaday, the pace setter. Green flag. And the inside lane takes the run on turn one, and the trucks on the lead lap are going to stroll a bit here.
Ned Jarrett, you look like you know what you're talking about. You see Hornaday there. He has set a pace in the early part of this run. You see some of the lap traffic going by him now. He's got his own pace, and he's going to wait.
And he probably is not too concerned about those guys getting their laps back. Here comes Jack Sprague in the green number 24. Certainly he wants to get his lap back. But Ron Hornaday knows that they're going to use up their tires doing this. He knows what he did in the first half. He'll have a good enough truck in the end that it doesn't matter if they're in the lead lap. He's going to let Jack Sprague go right on by. Look there.
Now, most of the rest of the trucks on the lead lap are following Hornaday's slow pace. But there's Rick Crawford in blue up and on the outside. The rookie wants to lead a lap here, and he just might get to as he follows 66 Reffner around Hornaday.
Boy, I'd chase that carrot all the way to the fourth turn, I'll tell you. If he give me that room, I'd try to make it, thinking maybe a caution would come out.
Four abreast. They were four abreast going in the corner because nobody can decide on what pace to run.
Well, there's Mike Wallace going back in his lap back. Now, as these drivers get their lap back, the thing that they want, buddy, you mentioned caution flag, that's exactly what they want early, so they won't have to run hard to stay out there. They'd like to see a caution flag come out now.
On the outside, for the lead, Rick Crawford in 14 and Mike Blitz in the 2. Back to turn 1.
And I don't think that bothers Ron Hornaday one bit.
Nope.
Saw him in the first part of the race. He convinced me. He made a believer out of me.
Ed, if you'll notice, though, when they're running for the lead, he's not giving up like he was to the trucks that are a lap down. He's making Crawford earn it on the outside.
Well, he also knows that that's making Crawford use his tires up a little bit more out there.
So here come the boards. Crawford in Petty blue, though no connection to Richard Petty, and number 2, Mike Blitz. They want the lead from Ron Hornaday. More on Mike Blitz. Dick Bergeron.
Mike, he's got more trouble than we could ever imagine. That battery that they put in at halftime, that thing wasn't fully charged. As a result, Barry Dodson, his crew chief, has told Bliss, turn off whatever you don't need. At the end of this race, that may well be the critical fans that cool the driver, cool the brakes, and cool the transmission. Question is, will Bliss's ignition system hold out for this entire event? Mike?
Mike Bliss has a mirror full of Tony Raines. Underneath him is Hornaday. There's that yellow truck of Raines.
Yes, Steve.
Who is trying to get his lap back. He is in 16th position, one lap down.
I'm going to tell you one thing.
Sure.
That three truck right there can really create a problem for Hornaday, because he was just as quick as Hornaday yesterday in late practice on a hot track.
Jay Sauter is fourth. Again, the Richard Childress number 3. You're riding with Tony Raines. Dodge, Mike Bliss just ahead. Back to turn 3. Rick Crawford, the race leader, up front.
Buddy, correct me if I'm wrong. I'll bet Ron Hornaday might not mind seeing a caution come out here in the next 5 to 10 laps. Before, he slowed down. You know, you get a little heat in those tires, and then you slow down during a caution, let them cool off, and then they don't have the tendency to heat back up as much after that. So maybe an early caution would even be good for him.
Ed, that's exactly why he won 2 national championships. That's exactly what he's doing right now. He's not getting the best out of the tires while they're new.
You're looking at Jay Sauter in that black number 3 from Ron Hornaday's truck. They are 3rd and 4th behind Rick Crawford and Mike Bliss. Then Jimmy Hensley, number 43, in 5th, and Rick Corelli, truck number 6, 6th place. Corelli has gained 21 positions in this race. Riding with Hornaday, Raines drops to the low side. Side by side for the lead up front. Will they be 3 abreast? Not quite. But Bliss and Raines are going to go underneath Rick Crawford to drop the 14 to 3rd place. And here comes Hornaday back up on pace.
Well, Raines trying desperately in the yellow truck to try to get back on the lead lap.
I don't mean to laugh while people are talking, but I just get a kick out of these short tracks. When they get to knocking and bumping and sliding around in the corner, I'll tell you what, I have a seat up here, but I hadn't used it.
How tough is it in that truck to control your temper when that starts happening? Well, it's Mr. Calm, Cool, and Collected, who never used the bumper, as you said at the start of the show.
Yeah, I was glad you didn't ask me about that. Oh, look at Rick Crawford get sideways in the 14 truck there. Hensley got into the back of him. He nearly went around.
Now, tempers?
Tempers? Well, this is just very good, close racing right now. And you're going to touch on a short track? You can't stand the heat. Get out of the kitchen.
All right, Tony Raines in that yellow truck is now back on the lead lap. And you're looking back from Raines at the leader, Mike Bliss. Now, there's 14 Crawford, 43 Hensley, and 6 Corelli. 4th, 5th, and 6th.
Now, there are 16 trucks on the lead lap. We had only 10 at the restart of this race.
We talked earlier about how a truck might go a lap down in the first half and come back and win this. Could happen. Back into turn 3 with Jimmy Hensley. Keselowski sneaking up there on the outside, along with Kevin Harvick. 75.
And Mike, we're seeing exactly the same thing.
The 14 is passing up. He is a lead lap, so you're running the 43 and the 14.
of the spotters telling his driver what's happening there. Rick Corelli in the car number, in the truck number six.
That's
but
Mike
we're
Brody.
Seeing them back up exactly the way they did before behind Hornaday as he sort of sets his own pace. And they could go faster than that right now. And that's what bunches them up.
He's gained 15 spots since the start of this event. I said 21. He started 21st. You're hearing crew chief Rick Rann and spotter Mike Gross for Rick Corelli. Heavy traffic here.
Boy, you can almost smell a caution when
running
sideways like this, three wide going in the corner. It could happen any second. I know that Joe Rutman's up there right now saying, man, would I love to see a caution.
Boy, we got a lot of trucks that you can see them running in there tight. There's Chuck Bowen. He's trying to make up some time and positions.
He was in a tight pack of traffic, Ned, and he and Kenny Irwin got together, and they just got together again.
Now, right back behind all of this, there's a guy that is just sitting back there running his truck, stay straight, not racing with anybody. We'll see if we can, well, Rich Biffle's the guy that I'm talking about. We're not being able to get back to him there right now, but he will be a factor before this race is over.
Rich Biffle is in 10th place alone. Now, here's that Irvin and Bound battle. See 98 and 99? One truck's white, one truck's black, and you won't tell which is what color by the end of the day if they keep this up. Here's what happened between the two of them a little bit ago.
See, Chuck Bound on the outside there. He gets a little assistance there. Very, very lucky to continue to move on there. Kenny Irvin got hard into Chuck Bound.
152 laps complete. Mike Bliss leads it. Ron Hornaday second. Jay Sauter is third. And Jimmy Hensley just moved up to fourth, taking that spot away from Rick Crawford. Rick Corelli is sixth. Dave Resende is seventh. Stacy Compton eighth. Butch Miller ninth. And Rich Biffle all by himself in tenth. There's your leader, Mike Bliss. Driving for Jim and Marlene Smith, the former USAC open wheel champion. Truck number two, CBS Sports coverage of the Colorado 250 will continue after this message and a word from your local station. One laps. Mike Bliss in a Ford. Ron Hornaday has risen to second place and Jimmy Hensley battles Jay Sauter for third, side by side every lap.
Mike, this has been about a 10-lap run here where they've been side-by-side. Finally, it looks like Sauter's going to win this. You see Corelli in the sixth truck coming into play right now.
Mike Bliss, fourth different leader of the day. And you ride with him. Oh, Tammy Jo Kirk just took a big bounce off the wall. Up there in turn three.
She had just got back in the lead lap not too long ago and trying desperately to stay there, Mike.
Now, she is fighting hard to stay on the lead lap, and as she came off turn two, she smacked the wall. Mike Bliss trying to put her a lap down, and for more on the race leader, Dick Berggren.
Mike, here at Colorado National, it's going to be on pit road. The crew chiefs are all up in the grandstand with the fans, including Barry Dodson. You guys have just changed your line. What are you doing, Barry?
We're trying to save the tires right now. We got lucky at the half. We had a dead battery. I pulled the diehard out and put a brand new interstate in. And the motor's running a lot better. And what we're doing right now, I'm giving it separation between us and Hornaday. I just told him, I said, your tires are your best friend. Take care of them.
Mike?
That is the truth. He is still, though, Ned, unable to put Tammy Jo Kirk a lap down. And when Tammy Jo got her lap back, the whole grandstand stood up. They're pulling for this lady.
I'm sure they are. And he doesn't want to press the issue too much because you can really use those tires up in a situation like this, buddy.
Ned, this might be just a real blessing in disguise. Right now, he's not overdriving, getting in the corner because he's afraid he'll get into Tammy Jo. He's actually saving his tires by racing her right now.
Yeah, you can tell that he's not accelerating fully when he comes off those turns as you hear that engine.
Now, Jimmy Hensley has been up in the top three. He has now drifted back to fifth, Bill Stevens.
Jimmy Hensley told me before the race he wanted to qualify up front and run up front. He got one of the two. He only qualified ninth. As you mentioned, Mike, he's in fifth, but he's happy to be toward the front. Remember, he finished third last week. He'd like to do at least that well this week.
Just in front of Hensley, Rick Corelli, the home track hero, number six, has moved on up. Corelli from 21st to fourth. And just ahead of him, number three, Jay Sauter.
16 of Hornaday in second, and Mike Bliss, the leader, number two.
Mike, as you watch the three truck go through the corner, he's just every bit as quick as Hornaday right now. I think these two trucks are very evenly matched, but Pirelli is really putting on a drive right now.
Certainly he knows this racetrack better than anybody else. He's got more laps on it than most of these guys.
And he's won, what, Nick said, 31 races here. But he said in the rookie meeting, he told the new drivers, he said, you really have to drive slow to go fast here. He says, don't outdrive the racetrack like I usually do, making a joke on himself. He's not had good finishes here in the previous two truck races. He might be headed for one today. Let's go to Ken Squire.
170 laps complete, 80 to go to decide it. For seven drivers who were a lap down at halftime, they're looking for a caution right now to regroup this field. If Hornaday begins to pick up the pace again, he'll begin nipping away at them. That 17th truck is Tammy Jo Kirk. She's the last truck on the lead lap. Meanwhile, the biggest question, I believe, is number 17, Rich Bickle, 10th position. He is running at the same pace that he had in the first segment. Hornaday is running a bit quicker. Question, is Hornaday beginning to put his tires at risk? We'll see.
You ride with Ron Hornaday, Ken. Down the back straightaway, past Ken's perch above turn three, and into the corner at the north end of the speedway. Out front ahead of him is Mike Bliss. Mike Bliss has not won this year. His best finish second at Homestead after making up two laps. Here's the battle for second place. Hornaday, left side of your screen, Jay Sauter, Rick Corelli. For more on Rick Corelli, here's Dick Berggren.
Rick Corelli has come all the way from 21st to the front of the pack, Mike. I'm with Rick Wren, his crew chief. How far can you go?
I'll tell you what. I think we're a little bit better than the second and third place truck right now, but Rick radioed in at lap 156, we've lost the cylinder. I thought I'd heard it spit in about 150, and he confirmed it. You know, it won't hurt us as far as, it'll help us with our tire wear up off the corner if the motor will stay together until the end of the race. That's going to be our big question.
Well, that's a new way to detune them, isn't it, Mike?
Sure is, buddy. As we said, not a bad thing.
Well, as Ned and I both have run up a racetrack very similar to this, many times up in North Carolina there, one thing you can do, you can get wide open if it's skipping a little bit and you don't break the rear tires loose. And everybody says the best friend you have is your rear tires on this racetrack.
We'll see if Rick Corelli can go the distance, or if Mike Bliss can win his first race of the year, or if Hornaday can win his third in a row. Welcome back to Denver, 64 laps to go. Mike Bliss, looking for his first win of the year, leads Ron Hornaday, looking for his fifth, and Jay Sauter. Mike Joy with Buddy Baker and Ned Jarrett. Ken Squire, Dick Berger, Bill Stevens bringing you CBS coverage today as you watch Ron Hornaday and Jay Sauter lap underneath Bill Sedgwick's number four, and Rick Corelli is right there as well. And number six, 14 trucks are on the lead lap. Tony Roper is the last of those. Mike Wallace and Tammy Jo Kirk have now gone a lap down.
Mike, as you can hear, they go down the straightaway. They're not even near wide open down the straightaway. That's why Corelli, he dropped the cylinder a little while ago, and he's able to keep up. So listen as they go down the straightaway. But look at this. Jay Sauter making a move for second place.
Sauter to the inside on Ron Hornaday. Bill Stevens has more. Oh, they bang together. Let's check with Bill down on one.
I don't know if you guys can notice it up there, but I'm standing there turn one, and Hornaday's driving style is dramatically smoother than most of the other trucks. He comes down the front straight and eases into turn one. The other trucks jam on the brakes, the noses droop. They're being a lot rougher on their rubber than Ron is. Let's go to Dick Berger.
Freddie Graves, his crew chief, is watching Ron Hornaday run through the corners. It seems as if he is running extra smooth out there, Freddie. Is that him or are you coaching?
I'm sorry, Dick, I just can't hear the question, but he's still running a smooth line. He's just trying to save the tires for the last 25 laps.
What do you think? Has he got it in him to win this thing? Can he go three in a row?
Well, we're hoping.
They are indeed, and he is running a smooth line, Mike Joy.
Ned, how hard must it be on a driver who's used to running flat out every single lap to be patient and watch these trucks go by you?
It's tough. There is no doubt about it. You have to commend him for the patience that he's displaying out there. Because, you know, you've got a truck right now that'll run, but you also got to think ahead and know what it needs to be at the end of the race, and that's exactly what he's doing.
So there's Hornaday in 16, and here is Rich Bickle. Bickle has just moved up past Stacy Compton, the rookie, and Rick Crawford. Rich Bickle is now in the top five. He was back in 10th spot about 20 laps ago.
And I think that he's another one that has really been managing his tires very well. He sat back there and run by himself for about 25 or 30 laps. No one even close to him. And here this battle goes on. They're using up their tires when they're doing that. But
and a little banging going on between Hornaday and Jay Sauter. Now Hornaday will try to pin Sauter behind the lap truck of Mike Wallace, and does.
Yes, he did, and as he started out, you can notice he made his truck very wide to take that angle off. They bumped just a little while ago when Sauter got by him, and I think he just remade him a little.
More on that, Bill Stevens.
Just got a report that Ron Hornaday was in touch with his spotter. The spotter said, "Ron, you're clear," but he wasn't. Sauter and he made contact. Ron said to his spotter, "Hey, what are you trying to do to me?"
Spotters are so important. The driver sits so low in that truck, has a good view out the front of the truck, but there's a lot of blind spots. And a good spotter is key.
And they rely heavily on them. And if he gets that signal that you're okay and mashes on it and he hits something, say, uh-oh, what happened here?
Let's check with Ken Squires.
54 laps to go. Mike Bliss, that number two truck, is as good on throttle control as anyone in the game. It's all that sprint car experience. He is so ginger with that throttle. And on a track like this, he's tough to beat. But in the last five laps, Hornaday has moved in four truck lengths. He is getting closer. The issue now is, has Mike Bliss spent that number two up in front, and Bickle, as Mike has been pointing out, he's the big question mark in this race. He and Rick Carilli in the six are on the charge. They are something to watch out here.
Mike Bliss, who you're riding with now, the race leader, a lot of versatility. First driver in USAC history to win three different division features at a single track in a single season. He did it at Indianapolis Raceway Park, where these trucks go the first week of August. Won a Silver Crown race, a sprint car, and a midget event there.
Well, just a second ago, Carilli was fighting for position there, trying to take second spot. You see Bickle, he's come from the back net.
And look how easy he made the pass. But we know that Carilli is only on seven cylinders, but he's getting traction off the turn, Bickle is, and tire management helps him to do that.
Under 50 laps to go. And there's the lead. Mike Bliss at number two, back to Ron Hornaday.
I got some advice for the rest of these drivers. Leave Hornaday alone. They hit him a few times there. It was like a wake-up call. He's going through the field right now. He's pulling down on our leader, Mike Bliss, about five truck lengths a lap right now.
12 trucks on the lead lap, led by Mike Bliss, Ron Hornaday, Jay Sauter, Rich Bickle, and Rick Carilli. We'll be right back to Denver.
When we started the day, we said there was a possibility of showers. The possibility looms larger. With 39 laps to go to the north of Colorado National Speedway, there's something brewing up there in the skies, and now we can see a bit of lightning. Down below us, as the laps run out, the leader continues to be Mike Bliss. And I think the question, gentlemen, now is, the temperature seems to have dropped about 7-8 degrees since halftime. Is that going to make a difference on these tires?
Well, it could very well, but we've made a difference right here as Hornaday has taken the lead from Mike Bliss. Ken, at this stage, as much mileage as they have on those tires, I'm not sure that would help a whole lot with lower temperatures. Might help a little bit, but Mike, the Ron Hornaday truck has passed Mike Bliss, and I think that tire management early in this half has helped.
Whoa, here comes Bliss right up on the tailgate. I thought he's going to make contact as they head into turn three.
Yeah, there's no soft pedaling it anymore. Here's Bliss. He's going to make Hornaday work for it and run for it the whole rest of the way.
Yes, and you have lap traffic, and you can see the storm he was talking about in the background there. Any time you cool the pavement, it helps the tires, but Hornaday's got better traction than the rest of them. It'll only help him more.
And right behind Mike Bliss, who you're riding with in second place, is Jay Sauter. and Sauter's coming hard. Now Reyes to the inside, three wide again, and a spin right behind them. The rookie, the 18-year-old Randy Nelson, has brought out the caution flag. Tony Reyes is trying to stay on the lead lap, and will as we go to caution.
Wow, this brings on another story, because that brings Bickle, the second fastest truck on the track, right on the tailgate.
Actually, I think he was the fastest, buddy. He was gaining on everybody, even Hornaday, as he was coming up through there. He had been about 5 seconds behind. He had closed it down to about 2.5 seconds, and so he was coming. He has managed his tires well here, too. So you're right. This is going to set up a whole new ballgame.
Rich Bickle, the point leader, 2 victories this season, and he is one of the 11 trucks on the lead lap. With 34 laps to go, we'll be right back.
Motor oil. Nothing outperforms Mobil 1.
After 217 laps, 4 leaders, 6 lead changes, just 4 cautions for 16 laps, and only 4 trucks out of the race. Robertson, George, Allen, and now Higgs out of the event. We're back to green, and Joe Ruttman on the inside is trying to get back on the lead lap once again. Hornaday, Bliss on the outside, Sauter, Bickle, Corelli fighting for the win here as the laps wind down. Nice restart by Ron Hornaday. He broke away.
Well, when he has to, he's the best starter in all of truck racing. You can see him get a good jump on Joe Ruttman, not letting him get into the ballgame. You see Bliss now coming by on the outside. Ruttman will let him by.
Ruttman had to run so hard to get his lap back at the first part of this segment of the race. Had to run hard to stay out there and to use his tires up. Let's go to the pits and Dick Berger.
With Ron Hornaday winning and leading so many of these races, his wife Lindy has become something of a TV star. But I got one question for you, Lindy Hornaday. What do you feed this guy for breakfast that he goes so fast?
I think Dale would be proud to know that he eats his Wheaties every morning.
Yeah, he's also a big soft drink guy. You ought to see him with a cola before the start of the race. I guess it works, Mike.
I guess it does. Rich Bickle is coming into play. Just off the right side of your screen, he's the fourth place truck. Here's Bickle, and he's closing right into Jay Sauter. Bickle has a fast enough truck, but does he have enough time?
Well, what he has to do now is really get track position on these trucks and not waste a lot of time or a lot of tires trying to get by him.
Well, that will be the key there, though, not using his tire trying to get by him. That's going to be tough to do. He's going to have to drive aggressive to get by the 3 truck of Jay Sauter and the 2 truck of Mike Bliss to get up to Ron Hornaday. And if he uses that up, what can he do with him?
Bickle to the outside, looking outside Jay Sauter, but Sauter gets a good run up off the corner out of turn 2.
Well, you're looking at Ron Hornaday go down in the 3rd turn right now. You can tell that Ron Hornaday is not overrunning the corners. He's making them run his pace, saving his tires, running his groove. He's doing it all right now.
You'd think they were coupled together like the trains they race here at this racetrack. Here is 6th place. Stacy Compton in the 86, Rick Corelli just ahead of them for 5th, and this is the bumper cam on 8th place, Jimmy Hensley.
Here they go,
3 wide. Corelli on the high side. He knows this racetrack best, and he knows you can go up there.
Gutsy move. He went up there and made it work.
Mark Compton up to 5th place in that number 86. Great run for the Virginia rookie who started in go-karts at age 6. And at 16, moved to late model stocks. Qualified 9th for the Winston Cup race at Martinsville. And now he's a top 5 truck. Back up to the front 4.
And they are running in a tight pack. On Hornaday still leads, but by Cliff right there, the 2 trucks, the black number 3 of Jay Sauter, 17 of Rich Bickle, the point leader.
For more on Jay Sauter, Bill Stevens.
Jay Sauter may be the wild card in this one. He's playing his strategy to the hilt. He said it with about 5, 6, 7 laps left. He's going to empty his bucket, and he told his crew he's got a lot of truck left underneath him.
I wouldn't wait that long.
I was sick to say, if he's got anything he's holding, he better use it. You know, Bickle keeps looking to the outside there on Jay Sauter. He may be the faller for Sauter. You hear him talking about having a lot of trucks. I think Bickle has a ton right there.
Yeah, I remember, too, as much as Rich Bickle wants to win this race, he is the point standing leader. And if you spin out of contention, those points fall by the wayside. Dick Bergeron?
You say Bickle has a good truck. Indeed he does, Mike. This is the same truck that he won both races with. We got trouble on the racetrack. Tammy Joe Kirk goes round and round and right in front of the leaders. Mike, take it.
Turn two, and it brings out the caution flag. As Kirk spins, she was two laps down to the race leader and drops to the tail end of that group. You see damage on the right rear. Left rear damage was earlier. 12th place in Phoenix this year. Her best effort in the series.
That's a pretty good damage to that truck, but still going.
She had a great career in flat track motorcycle racing. And that is not a Barbie doll sport, let me tell you. That is tough competition. And she did a great job there before moving up to Slim Jim All-Pro and now to the Craftsman Truck Series. Let's see what happened to Tammy Joe Kirk. Watch the number 7 truck, the pink truck.
Right here, she gets tapped, it looks like, by the 98 truck of Kenny Irwin. He goes on by. Several trucks go by on the inside. One clipped her as he went by.
They were battling for position, and I'm corrected. Kirk is one lap down. Kevin Harvin was the truck that clipped her. He is two laps down, but Kirk continues on.
And Kenny Irwin, I mentioned him, he was lucky to get through there and not do any more damage than was done.
A little rent sheet metal. Track crews had a busy day today. They've done a good job. Oh, the right side. It's a lot worse than the left. Buddy, you're driving that truck, all that damage is behind you. You don't even know it's there, do you?
You don't care right now.
Right.
You're just going to the end, and Tammy Joe has a lot of experience. She won at the Snowball Derby, as we talked about earlier, and she's a racer. Now, listen, this girl is not going to just go out there and ride around.
Dave Resendiz has taken his truck to the back pit area. Tomorrow on the CBS Sports Show, you haven't seen soccer till you've seen it played on a 40-yard long field on Miami's South Beach. USA battles Brazil for the Miami Cup. And Bernard, the Executioner Hopkins, defends his IBF middleweight championship against unbeaten Jamaican Glenn Johnson. The action begins at 4 o'clock Eastern Time, boxing at 5, here on CBS. 16, make that 15 laps to go as they will bunch up for the restart this time. On the lead lap, Ron Hornaday Jr. trying for 3 in a row. Mike Bliss trying for his first win of the year. Jay Sauter, point leader Rich Bickle. In fifth, the rookie Stacy Compton. Sixth is Rick Crawford. Seventh now, Rick Corelli. Eighth is Jimmy Hensley. Ninth, Tony Raines. Tenth is Butch Miller, who won the inaugural here. And then Dave Resendiz stays on the lead lap.
That was a great shot of Ron Hornaday there, gearing down, getting ready. He dropped her down in second gear. He's going to take off like a bullet when they start.
He'd better. Mike Bliss is hungry.
Yeah, you don't hold anything back from here on out, that is for sure. Power management is out the window. You're right, buddy. He just shot out there, got back down to the inside groove. While there's other trucks back there, his competitors fight for getting around the lap traffic.
And look at the lead he's built up in less than a lap.
He's amazing, I'll tell you. If I wanted to know how to start a truck in a race, I'd watch what this guy does.
I think they took the sandbags out at halftime. And I don't mean for extra weight. I mean for just laying back. Ron Hornaday is trying to put this away and join inaugural truck champ Mike Skinner, the only man so far to win 3 of these races in a row. Second place battle. Mike Bliss in the 2, Jay Sauter in the 3, and Rich Bickle in 17.
Jay Sauter, he's looking to the outside as he makes a move here, Mike, as they come off turn 4.
Bliss has a good run off the low line. In turn 4, beats him into the corner. Sauter comes back again, and Bickle is going to be a part of this. There's Bickle 17.
I think Mike Bliss was smart protecting that inside lane.
And Ned, I'm impressed with the fifth place drivers. Rookie Stacy Compton has never seen this speedway, but has he got it figured out?
He's been running very, very well. Look at him. He's beating on the back bumper of Rich Bickle. That's the 86 truck right there in your picture.
Mike, we had the pleasure of talking to Mr. Compton earlier today, and I tell you what, this guy is serious about his races. He's got the Western Cup in his mind a couple of years from now.
10 laps to go. Stacy Compton has fifth once for it, and he's going to get it.
That is
That's bump and run at its best. Now, will Bick will take it? That's the thing.
Well, that's what you talked about, the stop and run. But it worked right there for Stacy Compton.
Stacy Compton working on being the highest finishing rookie in this race. Just two trucks back, another rookie, Rick Crawford. For more on Stacy Compton, Dick Bergeron.
If he finishes here, Mike, it'll be his best career finish in the truck, and what a day it would be. When Stacy Compton began this series in 1997, he had absolutely nothing. 1 week before the first practice, they began by borrowing tools, borrowing trucks to haul the race truck around, borrowing engines, putting things together as best they could. They were even robbing dumpsters trying to get parts because the parts guys had already sold out early on. What an incredible performance to have come from that to fourth place so far today. And look, he may want more.
Dick, if he finishes in the top four, other teams are going to be borrowing setups from him.
I don't think he's ready for fourth. I think he's going to look on the inside as they start down the front straightaway. He's trying to take third spot. Stacy Compton's on the move.
Oh, that's a bumper to Jay Sauter. Say, hey, I'm back here. I want to go.
Stacy Compton from Virginia, driving late model stock since the age of 16 off that tough Virginia circuit. Sixth at Louisville, his best finish to date. He has improved on that today.
Running out of time. All of them have run out of time, of course. Ron Hornaday's concerned. He has checked out.
Compton started 14th, has moved up to fourth. Ron Hornaday, the leader. Second, Mike Bliss. Third, Jay Sauter. And Stacy Compton working on it.
Mike, Jay Sauter is used to this type of racing. The ASA circuit, he's used to people pounding that rear bumper. Does not seem to be bothering Sauter at all.
I think he is really holding Stacy Compton up right now. Jay's tires apparently have gone away on him because Rich Bickle has caught back up to them.
Yep, right behind him, Ned.
Yeah.
Here's Rick Crawford coming back again on Rich Bickle.
Oh,
and Compton gets into the three truck. He gets sideways. Compton backs off. Lenzi gets it under control. Now he's going to make the pass.
White flag in the wind. Here's Compton on the bottom. Sauter up high, lap truck ahead, move out of the way, Tom Hubert. Here comes Stacy Compton down to the bottom, and Bickle is inside Crawford right behind them, while Ron Hornaday is going to run away to the wind. Rocket restart, Ron Hornaday, wife Lindy looking on, checkered flag, three in a row, Hornaday. Second to Mike Bliss, third to Stacy Compton, then Jay Sauter. Finally, Rich Bickle holds off Rick Crawford.
Very close. That's for the fifth position. Wow, what a run for Ron Hornaday. What discipline he displayed.
Lloyd's of London may have to insure that educated right foot.
Look at the span here.
Well, this is a Hornaday trademark. A little spin to win. Now that's a victory dance. And a roll to victory lane. Well, you know, another thing about doing that big spin, nobody will know how little of his tires were left, because he just burned the rest of them right off right there.
That's right.
We'll be back to meet the winner and more of the stories in this 250 lapper at Denver today after this. Great race out in St. Louis. We've had a great one here today, and Ken Squires in the winner's circle.
Well, Rocket restart Ron Hornaday has pulled it off. He has now won his 15th career victory, and he'll be up to a tie Mike Skinner when they go to Topeka at 16. Listen, Ron, let me ask you, as we get down here to the end of this one today, Freddie Graves, here he is, the man who made the call.
Made what call? I don't know what call we made, but I'll tell you what.
Strategy at the beginning, you fooled Baker, you fooled everybody.
Well, I think that's what we were going to do, you know. Gordy Arbiter, everybody back at the shop, the fab guys, all the guys that back there was working on the ranch, everybody in the office. It takes a whole team, not just Fred Graves, but everybody standing behind me. What an awesome crew. Action Collectibles are number one in diecast. Goodyear tires are awesome today. Burger King. I can go on, but I tell you what, this one's for Buster Mullins. His mother passed away on Wednesday, I'm sorry. And, you know, this one's for you, Buster. And got to wish my father-in-law and mother-in-law happy 40th. You know, it's I gotta have everybody have a birthday or an anniversary.
Listen,
it's been working.
Listen, you fooled everybody, though. Everybody is so used to seeing you charge to just run it out, to see you back up that much at the start and then put it all together here today.
Well, I'll go back to the last year I came here and ran at a Winston West car here for the Straussers, and they gave me a heck of a car. And a lot of them switched to a different brand tire, and I stuck with Goodyears, and we had to do the same strategy. We almost got a lap down, and it was about 25 to go. We came back and did that. So we knew what we had to do. Freddie talked about it, and the old Teresa, thanks again. Ty, Don Hawk, everybody back in the office, and what an awesome day again.
What an awesome day indeed for Ron Hornaday and for Freddie Graves standing here. Freddie, did you get a little nervous when you got that far back?
Well, not really. I got a little nervous when we started racing a little bit too soon there, and we started trading sheet metal a little bit, and I told him to just calm down. We had a long ways to go. We hadn't just saved it for the last 25.
Congratulations on a great program here. Let's go to Dick Berggren.
Mike Bliss came into this event wanting to win his first of 1997. He's got three wins, one in 95, two in 96. Sure thought it was going to be today, but second can't be too bad, or can it, after all the problems you went through with overheating and with the problems with the ignition system?
Yeah, halftime, right about 10 laps before the halftime, we lost the battery. It wasn't running. Came in. We were running a little hot, and they broke an old water line or something. Got that fixed, put a battery in at halftime, and the SD Ford was strong on the start. Ron was laying back, but his Ford was so strong, Barry just said, don't spin a tire, just keep it going, get you a big enough lead, and keep it at that pace. And lap traffic killed us today. They held us down on the bottom so much that when you can't free the truck up, you use the tires up more than you want to, and that hurt us. We didn't tear the Goodyears up. They were a good tire, but Ron just had a little better truck today.
What has he got that he is so strong in these little short tracks?
Well, I think they got a good combination when they got Freddie Graves. Ron's real strong. He's ran here a lot. He knows there's a special groove around here. He knows it.
And this guy knows how to get his way around, too. Bill Stevens.
Here's a driver who's on a Rocky Mountain High, Stacy Compton. Not a bad day for the Rook.
Well, I tell you what. David Hudson, where you at? Our owner, one of the very few races he's not here. We wish he was here. You know, my mom and dad, Vicky, they usually come. They didn't make it this weekend. But I tell you what, hats off to Troy Selberg and this Impact Motorsports bunch. I tell you what, they put a truck out there. We knew we were good in practice. We missed qualifying just a little bit. We thought we were good. We thought we had a shot at the pole. And, you know, these guys done a great job with this Valvoline instant oil change forward. You know, they paced me. We had a good truck all race. And Troy kept coming on the radio. Cal, our spotter, kept coming on and say, just pace yourself, pace yourself. You know, easy in the corner, easy out. You know, I always laughed at listening to all the guys pace their drivers. But I tell you what, it paid off today. You know, Troy and the guys paced me. And we had an excellent run. You know, we got Chattanooga. We got Smoky Mountain Chew on the truck for the rest of the year, and it is a good weekend for us. First time here, we'll take it.
Stacy Compton finishes third, and Dick Berggren's with the fourth place guy.
The very first time Jay Sauter ever came to this racetrack, he was with a new team. They came with a new car. They really weren't ready. They came down, they got the very first green flag. Hood flew off, hit the starter in the nose. A better day today.
Well, yeah, I'll tell you what, these Richard Childress guys, they work hard. Gave me a good truck, and tire management was the key. I think I kind of killed it when I tried the second groove there at the end.
It looked like it was getting pretty physical at the end, and the right side of your truck is all beat up. How bad was it?
Well, you know, a short track racing gets a little physical, and that's what it's all about. When it gets to the end of the race, you got to do what you got to do to get the spot.
Okay, let's go to Ken Squire with Rich Bickle. Had a great run today, Ken.
Indeed he did. He gained 40 more points in his battle to win this Craftsman Truck Series Championship. What about the end of this thing?
Well, I tell you, I tried to save the tires the second half more than I did the first, and I thought we'd really have something for it at the end, and about 25 to go, the right front gave up on me, and I had a 100-lap truck, not a 125-lap truck today.
So now in the point standings, it's 21-48 for Bickle, and you have Sprague 102 back behind you. That's really getting the territory covered to give this Waltrip team a championship.
Well, Darrell said, you know, this is the second start of the second half of the season. He said, keep looking at the big picture, and, you know, this old diehard Chevy's like Timex. Keeps licking, keeps on ticking, another top five, and, you know, I want to get a little bit farther up that ladder, but I'll tell you, we'll take it today.
Last year, so many problems with this team, and this year, so many good finishes. You really can't be down about the kind of finish you got today.
I don't know. That's 11 top fives out of 14 races. If we keep doing that year and out, I don't know. Hornaday's going to have to win a lot more races to catch us.
Well, Hornaday's really on a roll as well. Rich Bickle with us. And now let's move along. Let's see. Where do we want to go next year? To Mike Joy.
Ron Hornaday Jr. celebrates his third victory in a row and four wins in the last five races. Five wins this season. That is higher than his total last year when he won the championship in this division. We'll have much more from Denver, Colorado after this.
NASCAR Craftsman Truck Series is sponsored by the Ford F-150. Strength after strength after strength. The more than 1,575 AutoZone stores across America. AutoZone, the best parts in auto parts. And by Wrangler, real comfortable jeans.
Welcome back to Denver, Colorado, where the celebration continues. CBS Sportsline will have complete results and analysis of today's race. And Monday evening at 7 p.m., I'll take your questions on Sportsline about CBS race coverage. My computer doesn't spell that well. I think it's dyslexic. But join us at 7 p.m. on Monday evening. Dick Bergeron is with Rick Corelli, the hometown hero.
I don't think this guy could have possibly passed any fewer trucks than anybody. Did you have fun out there passing all those trucks today?
I'll tell you what, we had a real good time today. I mean, be here in front of the home crowd, and unfortunately, we lost the cylinder about lap 150, and we're riding there, running along, but then the restarts killed me. But, you know, it's good to be out here. The truck's in one piece. We're ready to go to Topeka, and, you know, the Remax Chevrolet was running really decent. But, you know, it's one of those deals.
What was the spookiest moment for you in today's event?
The spookiest moment? I think Hornaday and Sauter got together, banged a little bit, and Ron come down on the side of me, and we bumped a little bit. Was, you know, that's no big deal. But just the lap cars, lap trucks, actually. Excuse me, there's $5. So. actually, lap trucks. Getting on the outside when we lost the cylinder, we didn't have no power to blow by them. So, you know, that's something. That's how I lost a lot of positions.
Mike Joy, is just beginning to rain out here. Back to you.
Oh, a little drip and a drop. Never hurt anybody. What a wild race. What a great event. And boy, were we fooled at the start or what?
I guarantee you, I thought Ron Hornaday had dropped a cylinder. He went way back, almost a half a lap back from the leaders right at first. You could have emptied my bank on that one. I thought something had happened to him, but he proved that he knows more about this track than we do or anybody else. They had a plan. They stuck to it. It paid off.
Man, I've never seen anybody pace a race quite like Hornaday did.
Boy, today. You have to admire his discipline for being able to do that, having a truck that would run faster than he ran early in each segment of the race, but knowing what he needed to have at the end of the race. And boy, he did exactly what he had to do. And a lot of others learned from the way he did it in the first part of the race, and they did it in the second part of the race, and probably resulted in a better finish for many of them, too.
Well, Bill Stevens is standing by with another smooth customer today. Bill?
Jimmy Hensley qualified ninth, finished eighth. You up near the front for a while. A little disappointed?
Well, a little bit. You know, we thought we had a pretty good truck yesterday last practice. And, you know, we ran pretty good the first half and we came in. We didn't really make a lot of adjustment. A little bit, tried to tighten it up just a little bit. And for some reason, it went the other way. And we were too loose right from the start. And, you know, just kind of hung on that second half. And, you know, thought we was going to really be up there and give somebody a good run for the win today. But, you know, it didn't happen. So, to come as Dodge finished eighth, we'll go to Kansas next week and try it again.
He's philosophical, if nothing else. Back to you, Mike.
How'd they finish today? Ron Hornaday Jr. gets that third in a row. Mike Bliss is second. Rookie Stacy Compton, Jay Sauter, point leader Rich Bickle, rookie Rick Crawford in sixth. Rick Corelli picked up seventh. Jimmy Hensley, rookie Tony Raines. Butch Miller on the lead lap. Dave Resendiz and Joe Ruttman in 12th.
And then we have Tony Roper, Kenny Irwin, Brian Reffner, Jack Sprague, not having a good day today, Tammy Joe Kirk, and Mike Wallace, who led for much of this race.
Terry Cook, Kevin Harvick, Bob Keselowski, Boris Said, who had to start last, Tom Hubert in his debut, and Bill Sedgwick, 24th.
Then comes Nelson, Bowen, Higgs, Allen, George, Robertson. All of those, of course, were laps down.
And here's how the points will shake out. After today, one race past the half point in the season, Rich Bickle is the point leader. And Jack Sprague didn't have a great day, so Bickle's margin expands to 102. Joe Ruttman third, Hornaday holds on to fourth, but closes in. And here's a look down through the top dozen. We'll be back with more from the Speedway here in Denver right after this word. The raindrops held off till just after the finish of this one. Ron Hornaday in victory lane, buddy, and closing in.
211 points back, Mike. Don't count Ron Hornaday out. Three in a row now. Hey, he can pull it off again this year.
Matt, a day of surprises led to a predictable winner.
Yes, it did. And again, how smart he and his crew chief were in managing their tires the way that they did. And it always makes for good racing on a short track like this, but still you have to have a lot of finesse because you can get into another truck so easy, get it banged up, get a fender on a tire, something like that, and run the whole day.
Well, I'm impressed with the run of the rookies. Compton third, Crawford sixth, Raines in ninth, three rookies in the top 10. Let's meet one of them with Dick Bergeron.
Rick Crawford had a great day today, led one of these races for the first time in his career. What's it feel like to be out front?
Feels good. I wish we was at a racetrack where I could hammer down all day and we'd stay up front.
Eddie had a nice run today. Ken Squire.
Well, the man who masterminded all of this, all of NASCAR, he was here today for sure. Back in the 40s, Bill France Sr. said,
if you take the cars that are most popular with America and you put them on a racetrack, you've got the romance, you've got the image, and you've got something special going. He would be so proud of what his son Bill and his grandson Brian have done with this truck division. You know, trucks are the most popular things we sell in the United States these days. And you bring them to these size tracks, this is exactly where NASCAR began years ago, up in Rhode Island. Then you have a new series that is just where NASCAR began back some 50 years ago. And France Sr., as usual, in charge of the weather, waited for the checkered flag before the rain started to come down. Well, thank you for being with us. NASCAR Grand National Racing is going to be here next week, and it's going to be a dandy on this brand new track near St. Louis. That's it for today. For Mike Joy, Fournette Jarrett, Buddy Baker, Dick Bergren, and Bill Stevens, Ken Squire saying so long from the Colorado National Speedway, where Ron Hornaday has won the 1997 Colorado 250. Join us next Saturday as the NASCAR Busch Series visits Madison, Illinois for the inaugural Gateway 300. Tomorrow, the CBS Sports Show kicks off at 4. It's Pro Beach Soccer, followed by the 12-round IBF Middleweight Championship featuring Bernard Hopkins and Glenn Johnson. This has been a presentation of CBS Sports, home of the Daytona 500.